So regarding SpaceX, we are all waiting for that second static fire attempt of Starship SN9, because without static fire, no high altitude test flight. Then we'd like to talk about an interesting idea for a Starship-based space station put forward by SpaceXvision.
Talking of space stations, Axiom Space has plans to build their own commercial space station segment at the ISS, and Tory Bruno is optimistic for a launch of Vulcan Centaur in 2021. Then how about using the famous Boston Dynamics robo-dogs for exploring the huge underground caves on the Moon and on Mars? Oh, and lastly, let's also talk aliens again. A lot to talk about, so stay tuned.
So we are all waiting for Starship SN9 to begin the second static fire attempt. And we want to thank Keith Weisner for the nice Starship photos on the thumbnail of this video. He recently moved to Boca Chica in order to witness history being written by SpaceX. So we remember that there was a short static fire on January 6th. Then the second static fire attempt should have taken place 2 days later, but it was aborted. And now the second static fire attempt must take place any day now, if you want to see a high altitude test flight. Most likely, a third static fire will be performed, as in the case of Starship SN8, where we also had three static fires. Road closure dates indicate that actually today, Monday, January 11th, should happen. And if not, then Tuesday, January 12th, and Wednesday, January 13th are the secondary dates. We think there's a good chance to see the high altitude test flight by the end of this week, should no problems occur. Then we have the mid-January date for a Starship launch, as we already predicted back in December. Then, still on the topic of SpaceX, SpaceXvision, who creates some really amazing animations of all things regarding Starship, made a really interesting animation about a modification of the Starship architecture. He calls his new concept the SpaceX Single Launch Space Station, or SLSS, because it can be launched with a single Starship Super Heavy launch. The similarity in name to SLS is certainly purely coincidental, we are sure. But it's a really interesting concept. Basically, it's a wider upper section of Starship that would be launched on a Starship-derived second stage, on top of the Super Heavy first stage booster. It would be 31 meters long and 13 meters in diameter, weigh 250 metric tons, and offer a truly gigantic interior pressurized volume of 2,200 cubic meters. So a bit more than twice the interior pressurized volume of the regular Starship, with its 1,000 cubic meters.
As a comparison, the interior pressurized volume of the ISS is 930 cubic meters. It would thus offer enough room for a permanent crew of 20 astronauts. With a diameter of 13 meters, one could actually even imagine it being rotated in order to create artificial gravity. In order to achieve 0.5 g of gravity acceleration, which might be enough to prevent bone and muscle loss, we'd be at 8.29 rotations per minute. For 1 g, we'd need 11.73 rpm, obtained by setting the centrifugal force equal to the acceleration force. It is not entirely clear to what rpm humans could actually adapt. Gray Beal found in 1977 through experiments in a 15-foot diameter rotation room that at 10 rpm, adaptation presented a serious challenge and that even pilots without any history of air sickness didn't fully manage to adapt in 12 days. However, Lackner and Dizio found in 2003 that sensory motor adaptation to 10 rpm can be achieved relatively easily and quickly if subjects make the same movement repeatedly. So the SLSS space station concept might allow for artificial gravity by means of rotation, which would be a big plus in our eyes. Anyways, the concept is really great, it would be also cheap, and we could really build huge space stations with very little effort. Hopefully Elon will see this, and who knows, maybe he'll get inspired to also build such Starship space station variants.
On the topic of space stations, a company that has specific and fleshed out plans for building a space station in low Earth orbit is Axiom Space. They want to attach their first module to the ISS in 2024, with more modules to follow later. Basically, a new private space station would then grow in the years following 2024, still attached to the ISS. Then, if the ISS should retire in 2030 as currently planned, the Axiom station would detach from the ISS and thus carry on the legacy of the ISS. NASA and the other space agencies that are currently maintaining and working on the ISS can then transition to the new platform. NASA would thus lease the new space station, which would be a lot cheaper than the insane $3.5 billion annually which NASA currently has to provide in order to operate and maintain the ISS. This sounds like a good plan to us, and if we could combine that with a few SLSSs from before, low Earth orbit could become an interesting place in the 2020s.
And please subscribe to our channel, because we are a non-PC space and technology channel, something that doesn't exist often on YouTube, one might say. And since anti-PC and YouTube doesn't go together so well hand in hand, as you might know, we publish our videos also over on Odyssey, so you can subscribe to us also over there. Hopefully one day the power of the big tech giants will be much more diminished thanks to decentralized alternatives such as Odyssey. Then we have an interesting tweet from Tori Bruno, the CEO of the United Launch Alliance, ULA. He shared this cool picture here on Twitter of two Blue Origin BE-4 engines installed on a Vulcan Centaur for pathfinding operations in preparation for a launch in 2021. The Vulcan Centaur is ULA's next launch vehicle and has been under development since 2014. 7 years of development and still hasn't flown. Well, at least better than SLS. It will be able to lift 27.2 metric tons to low Earth orbit, and there are plans to make some parts of the rocket reusable, although it has become awfully quiet around the reusability aspect. The BE-4 engines were announced to be salvaged after each flight, but not many new details have emerged since this was announced back in 2015. We'd be happy to see the Vulcan Centaur launch this year. It would be a surprise to be sure, but a welcome one. And now to the inevitable robot uprising apocalypse. You know it will happen. We know it will happen. And if we look at the way how we treat our fellow robots, I mean, just look at this here, then it is absolutely understandable that they hate us and that it's only a matter of time until they will rise against their masters.
But until then, maybe we could use them to our advantage. The Boston Dynamics Spot, for example, which basically looks like a robotic dog, might be used for exploring the big underground caves on the Moon or on Mars. In a presentation on December 14th, at the annual meeting of the American Geophysical Union, researchers from NASA's JPL introduced their Mars dogs, which can maneuver in ways rovers never could. The robots are equipped with artificial intelligence and an array of sensing equipment to help the bots autonomously navigate treacherous terrain and subsurface caves. These Mars dogs are currently being tested, as you can see on this picture here, in caves on Earth. Researchers hope that the robots will soon be used on the Moon or Mars to explore the fascinating underground cave and lava tube systems there. Especially on Mars, that would be highly fascinating, since many suspect, us included, that these underground networks are a refuge for life, which might have fled the harsher getting conditions on the surface of Mars billions of years ago. In these caves, conditions are much life-friendlier, because no UV, solar, or cosmic radiation can damage biological systems there. Also, in the deeper regions of the crust, the temperature might be higher due to residual heat from the interior of Mars. Anyways, these robo-dogs might be a viable way to explore those fascinating places until human explorers arrive.
And now finally, alien stuff again. Come on, it has to be every few weeks. We just love talking about that stuff. And Avi Loeb, the famous Harvard astronomer, now published a new book called Extraterrestrial: The First Sign of Intelligent Life Beyond Earth, in which he talks about his theory that the interstellar visitor to our solar system called Oumuamua was actually not a regular comet or asteroid, but a solar sail built by an intelligent technological civilization. This object was discovered on October 19, 2017, 40 days after it passed on its closest point to the Sun, whizzing through our solar system at a speed of 26.3 km per second relative to the stellar background. But a few things made this object really peculiar. Since we don't have any high-resolution pictures of the object, light curve measurements showed that it had a really strange, extremely elongated shape, which can be described as cigar or disc-shaped, and that it was extremely reflective. Later research showed that a disc was somewhat more likely based on the data, though the conventional view has leaned towards the cigar shape, which is easier to explain in nature, according to both Loeb and other researchers who have looked at the problem. But the biggest anomaly that Avi Loeb sees as the most important for his theory of an alien light sail is that the object accelerated on its way out of the solar system. Now indeed, this could also happen with comets because the Sun heats them and then outgassing occurs, which in turn accelerates them. However, no outgassing had been observed in the case of Oumuamua. Then the scientists came up with the idea that the outgassing had not been detected because of unusually large dust particles, which would have been counterintuitively harder to spot. Avi Loeb in his book criticizes the scientific establishment for trying to maintain with any means or explanation necessary to have Oumuamua be a natural object.
He says that the scientific establishment is engaged in groupthink and that they want to avoid anything to do with extraterrestrial civilizations in order to protect their reputation, and that people who want to pursue such topics are regarded as nutjobs by the science community. We completely agree with him. Only 30 years ago, you were seen as a nutjob if you would want to hunt for exoplanets. Back then, the scientific community believed that there aren't any planets around other stars. Now, 30 years later, we know that every star has planets, and that there are trillions of them in our galaxy alone. Of course, if we try to construct the weirdest theories just in order to avoid ever having to admit to have discovered something of alien origin, then we shouldn't be surprised that so many people still believe in the Fermi paradox. This mindset has to change if we ever want to learn more about the universe in which we live. And theories such as Avi Loeb's light sail theory should be treated exactly the same way as all other theories. Namely, they should be judged only based on evidence and nothing else.
And if you would like to know what else amazing stuff will happen in spaceflight in 2021, you can watch this video right here where we gave you an overview of all the cool stuff which will happen this year.
So thanks for watching the JS Space Report, and I would say, on to the future. And now you can just say, if you're wondering what else will happen in 2021 in space.
Yeah. That's nice. That's perfect.
Then just watch our video.
Mm-hmm.
It was not cool, right?
You can see it again if you want.
Yeah, good. I don't want, but I know. Google Papa doesn't like it for certain.
Okie dokie.